Hello and welcome to Library Grindhouse, where the only ticket you need is your library card. I'm Jesse.
And I'm Leah, and this week's video is the 2020 film, VHYes.
Awesome. So, all right, well, we open with the Oscilloscope Laboratories logo, which I don't know if you knew this, but yeah, it was founded by Adam Yauch.
Oh, I did not know that.
RIP, member of the Beastie Boys. Gotta say a little something that's long overdue.
I did not know that.
Yeah, that's his like movie shingle, and so that's pretty cool.
All right.
Yeah, so which is perfect since we're dealing with an old school like video and DIY sensibility, as well as the 80s when the Beastie Boys came up.
Yes.
And Adam Yauch is all about the DIY thing, if you know anything about him. But anyway, so we open with some wedding footage that quickly cuts to Christmas morning, and one of the presents under the tree was a VHS camcorder, and Ralphie, the camera operator, put in his parents' wedding tape in the camcorder and is taping over it.
Ralph, did you put a tape in that?
Yeah.
Which tape?
I found one underneath the entertainment center.
Was it blank?
I think so.
I feel for him. I think it's so cool.
You feel for him?
I feel for him, yes, because he's going to get into so much trouble.
But I have the question, did he do it on purpose, was my question.
You and I have talked about this prior, right after we watched this movie, about I don't think he meant to do it, but it does. You brought up some good points where it does kind of...
Well, we'll have to see. We'll see. As we talk about the movie, we'll have to see. So anyway, so they discover that the camcorder can be plugged into the TV to tape things like a sucky DVR, basically. So yeah, if you're too young to know about VHS tapes, yes, it's basically we had to put in a blank tape, hopefully blank, and then record stuff like animals to a tape. Not a nice little hard drive, no skipping, like commercials, you had to fast forward.
Yeah.
It was.
Library Grindhouse will be back after these messages.
Unofficially brought to you by the book What's Inside a VCR, available on Hoopla. 24 pages of hard-hitting, scintillating detail will not fail to capture your imagination. If you have never encountered a VCR, this book is for you.
And now back to the Library Grindhouse.
Yeah, it was crazy.
And the commercials back then were almost the best part. Whenever I see an older commercial, I'm just like...
We didn't know what we had, did we?
No, we didn't. We did it. And now all the commercials are just like, oh, why are there commercials? We hate ads.
Well, it's all like urinary tract infection medications and stuff like that. Then again, that's probably what I watch because I'm old. I get the catheter commercials, you know. It's just like, oh my gosh. Well, okay, yes, I get this medication will kill you if you take it. Awesome, thank you. Anyway, so side note, my family got a camcorder for Christmas in 1986 from my grandparents, and we also had a VCR from them as well, so we didn't need the camcorder to record TV. So we, although I may remember my dad dubbing some rental tapes.
Are you serious?
With the camcorder to the VCR. But my memory's a little fuzzy on that. Okay, technically we may actually have footage of some of that.
That's so funny.
Yeah, maybe we'll cut some of that in if you're good.
If you're good. You have to be good in order to see it, though.
I mean, who doesn't love Casualties of War with Sean Penn and Michael J. Fox? Or the Ten Commandments with
goodness.
Yul Brynner?
My goodness.
Yes, I have family videos with that cutting in, like it's...
just like this movie.
Just like this movie, it's pretty great.
Now, whereas I had a camcorder, we didn't, and it had the mini...
was it Hi-8 or was,
no,
oh, it was
the
mini VHS.
The mini VHS yeah. tapes mm-hmm. in it. I do find it funny whenever I watch them because I have recorded TV shows off of them too. So like you see me and my friends like rollerblading around and then it cuts to like... Rock of Love or something crazy like
oh my
like
gosh.
Some next on VHS. It's just bad. It's really bad.
Rock of Love. I knew I was gonna get hepatitis just watching that show. It's just oh my gosh. Anyway, so we have footage of Ralphie and his best friend lighting a firework of some kind, but the friend messes up the recording, which of course is so just like didn't realize how it worked or...
But that's the way how it works. Like, that's the way it happens. I feel like...
Associated with old people, but I guess kids wouldn't get it either.
I feel like my friend Aubrey and I have so many, like, videotapes of us like, are you ready to watch this? Yeah, hit play. And it was already recording, and then we hit it again, so it's just...
Nothing. And it's
nothing.
Like, hit it again. It's like, oh, man, that was awesome. I can't wait. Let's go watch
it. Yeah, and then it's like, we can't recreate it. And then, like, maybe right afterwards it'll be us trying to recreate it, but it's not as fun or as big.
Oh, that's such a bummer.
So,
oh, man.
If any of you guys have had a camcorder before, you have to watch this movie, and you have to feel the pain of the,
yeah.
We missed the best part of this.
With smartphones, it's hard to mess it up.
It's
you
true.
Still can. But I think it's a little harder with smartphones.
It is harder. I agree. It kind of takes that. When I was watching this movie, it definitely makes you feel for like the good olden days.
The analog days. Yeah. Of just like, yep. So then he pranks his mom with a whoopee cushion, standard kind of stuff. Then we get some news footage about the Siege of Noriega and Project Just Cause, like the video game. I was like, oh my gosh, because those all take place like in Latin America.
That.
It's like Operation Just Cause. I'm like, oh man, I love those games.
I did not catch that.
Oh yeah, they're wild.
Oh man, that's so funny. That's pretty great.
Yeah.
I was trying to watch the banner on what it said, like on the news station, so I'm glad that you caught that.
So then we get a Bob Ross parody where the painter likes mixing a little bit too much.
I love Joan. I love it. I absolutely love it.
It is worth watching just for her alone, I will say.
I mean, her entire outfit, the glasses, everything, the way how she speaks, I want to be her. Mm-hmm. I want to be Joan.
And then we got a home shopping parody with that guy from Reno 911 and other things.
The guy from Reno 911. I love how that's how we know him. The guy from Reno 911.
Well, I mean, it's not Robert Ben Garrett or Garant, his like cohort.
I just think of him as the short shorts guy.
Yeah, exactly. That dude. So yes, Thomas Lennon from Reno 911 is in this home shopping parody. And then we have some commercials, which are pretty fun. Now, it all feels way too constructed and convenient. It doesn't feel quite as naturalistic as I'd like in terms of how it's set up, but maybe I protest too much.
I just keep on trying to think like he is a 12-year-old boy. You know what I mean? So like maybe he's recording some stuff and then he goes back over, records some other stuff because he doesn't have enough room. He only has this one tape that he can find. Because it does feel that way. It feels like
everything
it flashes in and out.
Feels too convenient of just like okay, so we've had enough of this and then like so we don't get too inundated with whatever. I feel like it would just be him and his friend taping all kinds of crazy stuff versus
the TV, which is true. I mean, like I try and think back again, always been a huge film buff, loved recording everything. I probably have 10 different, just those mini VCR, whatever they're called, of my friend and I literally just like skating around the neighborhood, nothing going on.
Right.
But at the same time, I feel like since he's so much younger, he is actually trying to do the TV thing, trying to hook it up to the TV, watch this. I think it just shows how scattered he is.
Kind of, but I think they could have done something really effective with like a tension or a conflict with the parents or something like that of like, hey, I need the camcorder to tape blah, blah, blah. And then we get like the taping
That's
stuff.
True.
Or like have it be like a tension thing of like he's trying, he wants to do this, his parents want to do this. There's like this thing there, which makes us wonder, like, again, is he taping over this wedding thing on purpose? Which another note I have is I don't think much of any wedding footage would be left. I feel like that's not really how VHS works.
What do you mean? Like
that there'd only be enough, like some left at the end. Like at the end, we discover like it goes to the wedding or something. And it's like, oh my gosh, like it wouldn't like seg in and out unless he accidentally like hit fast forward after stopping record.
Yeah.
Something like that, which I guess maybe I could buy that there's like some war, like the tape starts and then it starts recording and so we get like
those little glips of it.
That's where I just don't think it works that way.
He could have, or else he could have, you know what I mean? When he's trying to make more room on the tape, he could rewind it and that's why we get the little glips of the TV shows. Like maybe he did record all of it and then he stopped, but the timeline wouldn't have worked that way, I guess. Because all of this happens over the course of...
It's supposed to be chronological.
Like 2 days, right? Or 3 days, something like that. So
I started to take notes on some of that, I think. But I'm going to try to let it go at this point when I'm watching the movie.
But then again, also you have to remember, like, he's a kid. He got this for Christmas. He is so excited to use it.
I feel like the family got it for Christmas.
I thought that was his Christmas present.
Really?
Yeah, I think it was his Christmas present.
But it felt like they were all kind of like into it, like, oh, look, you can tape TV shows on it. Like, the parents didn't even do research on it. In 1987, this thing was like $1,000.
I know, but I think that's them trying to be like, you can do this with it. Because part of me feels like his parents obviously have a rough marriage, which we will get into more.
Yes.
And I feel like they were kind of doing this to be like, here's something cool that you can do. You can run off and play with this while we're handling things. You can film whatever you want to film. And you can even watch TV on this. You can do this. I think that was them trying to point out everything that camcorder could do. That's my take on it, at least.
All right. Still, that's That's Adam Goldberg of the Goldbergs level of like gift giving. I'm just like, how much money is this family pulling in to be like, here's a literally in like $5,000 worth of gear in 1987.
Yeah.
In our money.
And that was a nice one. Like when he shows himself in the mirror holding that camcorder, it's a nice camcorder for back in the, obviously. So they had to have spent a pretty penny on it.
Sure. Absolutely. So then we get a crazy ad for Umbro's security company where a thief called Mr. Nightmare breaks into a house, threatens a little girl, and then is shot to death with 1,000 bullets in front of the girl while the security guard mouths, I'm sorry. It is crazy.
It's so funny that the girl just has blood splattered. Then she go like, thank you, Umbro's. Like the typical
At the end, the sunshiny, like, thanks, guys.
Thanks, Umbro security. You saved my life.
Blood drips down her. Like, it's pretty nuts. And so the painting lady, Joan, is a UFO believer who has them in her painting and will be adding in the focal point, Dennis Rodman?
Remember, every brushstroke is a sentence in a story. And in this story, I'm dunking on Dennis harder than I've dunked on anyone in the 23 years that I've been alive.
It's a little anachronistic since Rodman wasn't on the Bulls with green hair in 1987.
That is true. He was on the Pistons then.
Unless she can see into the future.
Which she might be able to. She seems like that type of person. You know what I mean? She seems like she's...
By the end of it, you get a vibe of like, no, she totally
She's in tune with something.
Something, yeah. And then let's see here. So 10 of the same. So what is Genesis to do when he accidentally kills his son with chemicals thrown over his shoulder? Clone 10 of his son, that's what? And not all the Zacks are the same race or gender. What progressive fun.
I know. This is another one of those commercials where I'm like, okay, this has like a step-by-step,
meets Multiplicity,
Saved by the Bell, meets Family Matters, post-Urkel creating his machine.
The evil Urkel.
Yeah, like...
Was it evil Urkel or was it just like hot, spicy Urkel?
It was that, yeah. Hot, it was like Urkel? You had like the geeky Urkel and then you had like, what was his name? Devon? I forget. A different type of Urkel.
Suave Urkel, yeah. So we also have a super morbid Antiques Roadshow parody with receptacle for hearts. Actually, it's a bowl. A porcelain piece used for skeet shooting?
I love how
would shatter.
I love how when he's going through and he's like really graphic. Yeah, they would take the heart and they'd put it in this thing and it would leak out. He was like going into all this detail. And then later on, just at the very end, he just goes, oh, nope, it's actually a bowl. Like, he made this whole entire...
Like, story
out of
it.
Yeah, this whole story. And it just... Oh, actually, it's a bowl. You can eat cereal out of it. Here you go. Like, one of those
things. This was used for ritual sacrifice in the Mayan days.
I wanted to see that on an Antiques Roadshow when someone's like, this is worth millions. I can feel it. And they're like, nope, this was a...
Actually, quick update. No, this was actually worth $1.95. It was actually... You got it from UPC codes you'd send in from, like, Frosted Flakes.
Exactly.
Like, I don't know. It's... Well, those things were that, yeah, it's like, that would be pretty funny. No, actually, this is IKEA, so not a Chippendale dresser, as we said earlier. We regret the error. But yeah, so we have a grandpa rocking out to a punk band, and we earn that R rating with the lyrics, if nothing else.
And that is that PBS style, like, you can just tell his daughter's...
It's public access style, yes, that's what I meant.
In
the girl's house, it's like... Wayne's World, like literally like parents' basement, like, okay, sweetheart, we know you wanted to do this show about music, we'll entertain, you know, we'll let you try it.
And I love how like the band is literally just nothing but curse words, the dad is having so much fun rocking out, and then the daughter, once it calms down, they're starting to do the interview, he just asks some simple question, she's like, Dad, stop it, you're embarrassing me. It's so typical.
I'd be embarrassed listening to that music with my parents.
I know, I don't think I could do it, but it's so typical teenager, like, stop embarrassing me, Dad.
So yeah, definitely public access of some kind. We have an interesting show interviewing a psychologist whose life was exploring the pathology of VHS owners and culture. Taping too much can lead to a psychotic break.
Dun, dun, dun.
Tape narcissism. Taping things warps reality. And she posits that people having mini VHS camcorders in their pockets, filming their own deaths as they fall off cliffs. Celebrities will be elected to political office, which is already happening, at least with Reagan, if not Sonny Bono. And she thinks this is the beginning of the end of civilization. So obviously a thing against smartphones.
Yeah,
and all that
I'm just staring into the camera like, yes.
Right.
What is going on today?
Exactly.
It definitely has those touches like.
Trying to comment on. What
exactly.
We're doing now.
What's happening today where everyone has to, you know, take a picture of their food even before they eat it or say where they're at, all of that stuff. They're calling it, was it tape narcissism? Is that what you called it?
Yes, tape narcissism.
Tape narcissism. tape narcissism.
Yes, it's a pattern of collecting and recording your experiences on VHS that eventually alters the foundation of your reality.
Needless, well, she didn't know. Tapes are no longer around, really.
But it is ubiquitous.
But
it's
in
our pockets.
Yeah.
I mean, obviously, this movie came out in 2020, so it's obviously, in hindsight, they're trying to make a comment on things. Been kind of funnier if we actually had someone from that time actually talking about it.
But, yeah.
You know, it's constructed. It's kind of fun. So then we get Ralphie whimpering on December 27th, and someone's yelling. I mean, is it his dad? Like, it sounds like there might be a fight going on.
I think so. I think this is when we're starting to see that his parents have been fighting. And it's so close to Christmas. I feel like it kind of made it, that's another reason why Christmas time, it's supposed to be this happy thing. They got him this big gift, and then immediately, like, they can't even hold it back for a day. They're already fighting. You can feel the tension between his parents.
Gosh, but you felt the whole thing, like, December 26th. Like, people have already hauled their tree off to the dump.
Yeah.
It's just like, Christmas is over.
Christmas is over.
It's like, even like 12:01, like, the morning of the 26th. It's like, it's done. Like,
take
all the
light, down.
Take the lights down. It's over. It's like, that's what just Christmas just starts. 12 days, people. Anyway, now the Flimbats are back.
No, yeah.
So Ralphie's recording like a mixtape of some kind, and then he takes mom sitting at a table, which is a little weird, but hey, whatever. And then we get.
I mean, wait. I have a bunch of films of me taping random things off in the distance, like my dog just in the yard, just walking around.
Portrait of a dog.
Yeah.
As a young pup. 828 power line to cactus to death of a watermelon.
Yes, so that is when he is trying to destroy this watermelon on film, and instead it just rolls down the driveway. Like, it just keeps rolling and rolling and rolling, and he still thinks it's cool. But it's one of those things, like, when you're a kid, you film the most random stuff and you think, like, it's the most amazing thing ever. And then when you watch it later on, when you're older, you're just like, cool, I filmed a watermelon rolling down a driveway. Awesome.
So I'm gonna be like, Dad, you gotta film this. I made this cool trap, and it's like the worst ridiculous thing. I was trying to do some cool Rube Goldberg thing, and it just was. Oh, I was six. What do you want? Anyway, we get some video of a spider web, and then mom and dad are going out. He can use the new microwave. Now, side note, we got our microwave a little bit earlier than that. It was huge.
Yes.
It was like the size of like this half of this table. And I think it was an actual radar range or whatever.
Really?
Like from radar. Like,
yeah.
Which is how kind of the technology came about, if I'm not mistaken. It lasted at least 10 years.
I just remember our microwave being wood paneled.
We did not have a woody microwave.
Yeah, we had a woody microwave.
That's pretty awesome. Ours was not.
That's like really the only thing I remember about it.
Yeah, ours was nuts. And it had like a big old honking dial the size of like a wall clock. And a giant, I mean like 1 inch by 1/2 inch silver button. It was just like, bam, like you're starting that microwave. And there's no spinning turntable. So like you had to like really stir your
rotate
food.
Rotate it. As you, yeah,
yeah, it was just, it was old school because I'm old. Anyway. So his best friend Josh comes over. They watch Hot Winter by Dick Pierre from 1982. One of the first films about global warming.
I can't believe you're the world's leading climate scientist and a successful bodybuilder, Dr. Manly. Is there anything you can't do?
However, I remember a greenhouse effect being used back in the 80s, but hey, whatever.
Hot Winter is funny too, because obviously it's supposed to be like a late night television show. So the host of it, which kind of reminded me of, what's his name? The Unsolved Mysteries man.
It's Robert Stack?
Yeah. He had that feel to where it was just a dark room and like his face was half lit. But
right.
It's a late night television show. So like back in the day, you know.
You would stay up all night.
Yeah, you would stay up all night to watch these sort of risque-er shows. So that's what the kids are doing. However, since it's public,
yeah, so
they cut out all of the bad scenes.
All the suggestive content's been edited out. Yeah, it's a straight
just
up porn
guy.
Film.
Yeah.
You basically just get the awkward climate change dialogue,
which
is pretty hilarious. I kind of want to watch the whole thing edited that way. It's pretty funny.
I know. I thought that was a pretty cool touch, too. That was
like they need
funny.
To do, like, that should be on DVD extra where they have, like, a 15 minute, like, here's what it would be like with all the fun stuff edited out. It's just the awkward, terrible acting about climate change.
It's
anyway,
great.
So then on the TV Guide channel, we keep seeing clips of Serfs Up, SERF, where medieval peasants present modern economic realities like the top 42 wealthiest people having as much as the billions of other people combined, but it's like medieval times,
yep.
Which is pretty funny. Then again, Monty Python did that in Holy Grail, so, you know,
yeah.
What are you going to do? So then blast off those pounds, aerobic show. The higher the room, the bigger the blast off, which was pretty fun. I definitely remember the aerobics days.
And that workout video is funny, too, because when you watch it, you know, just like our Freddy, our
yes.
Killer cardio,
yes, from episode one.
It was exactly like that, like as cheesy of a workout video as possible, but you have to watch the people in the back. So if you're watching this
right.
before you watch VHS, watch the people in the back. I promise you will love it.
Yes, it's fun. And then we get the Soundball 2000 narrating by Susan Sarandon. I'm like, what? They got Susan Sarandon for this?
Isn't it Susan Sarandon's son who directed this? Or doesn't she have a family member who like created this? I think so.
You have to tell me, Leah.
I think so.
Cool. Well, if so, great. If not, kudos on getting Susan Sarandon on board. So basically, the Soundball 2000, your date can't hear you use the restroom if you put it against the door. So yeah, that's pretty funny.
They don't even comment on, like, what would you do if you were on a date and this person's carrying this big suitcase that's just a folded up wall? Just for the fact, like, I have a phobia about you hearing me use the restroom. Like, I can't. I wouldn't, like, that's not a huge red flag.
No, that's the red flag thing all over the place. Like, anyway.
Next.
Yeah. Right. So, Home Shopping Channel is now selling drug baggies with smiley faces, zebras, etc. on them, which is pretty funny.
But he says that they're not drug baggies. You can put your sugar in there. You can put
your oregano.
Yeah, he's just listing off anything
your aspirin,
small in there. It's great.
And then we get the Boyd and Jules murder mystery. And then someone pukes during blast off. Let's see, we get Blood Files, The Witch of West Covina, a sorority party goes horribly wrong, so it's like a true crime show.
And that was funny, too, because it was almost like the Salem Witch Trials type thing. You know, it's filming people while they were in jail, true crime, talking about what is happening with them. And I just love... I don't know if
just escalate.
It's
the best part of this movie is watching all this stuff just get taken to 11, just watching that dial just turn.
Yep.
Turn. So by the end of it, everything's just...
insane.
Oh my gosh, what are we watching?
And I like how they do go back, which I know is kind of what you were saying, where it is very, not scripted, but...
I mean, you can tell how constructed it is. I wish it felt more natural, like there was give and take, like on the camera, like we get... Hey, stop taping. Stop filming this. I need to, you know, my show's going to be on or something like that. Or like, you know, that sort of thing where it's like, it felt like we had a reason for being taped or like, I don't know. But it's fine. It's a fun movie. I'm not that hung up on it. It's just, I started thinking about it because that's what I have to do because I know I'm reviewing it. So Susan Sarandon, we get her pimping Flexi Cream, which makes you crazy flexible.
Oh, her doing like bends all around the office.
And then we get an adventure show saying to invest in Betamax, which is pretty funny because even by 87, Betamax is pretty much done. So Home Shopping is now selling products to carry hard drugs, a briefcase with bricks of cocaine, Pacific Ocean tested and approved. Because, of course, Colombia.
Because, of course, Colombia.
What's the 80s? I mean, everyone, like Scarface, it's like going to Colombian Scarface. I mean, it's all those cartels. Like, of course, it's even if you've watched Modern Family with Gloria talking about Colombia and stuff.
So funny.
And then we go back to Blood Files. Rachel's dressed like a magician. She pulls a card from her hat.
Magic tricks. What? How did she know the card? How did she know the card? And the entire time in the background, she's like,
a witch.
It's magic. And she's even trying to like be like, I can show you how, which is, of course, a magician's no-no.
Right.
But she's even doing that, and everyone is freaking out. It's great. Like, when I was this age, this is what I would have been recording would have been magic tricks, actually.
Sure. Yeah, no. And it's like, yeah, but they're like, they're on fire.
Yeah.
And the experts are still puzzled as to how Rachel knew the card Paulina had picked. Which I'm just like, it's just a card trick.
It's a card trick.
Which is part of the funny. It's like, oh my gosh, they burned her as a witch because she did a
card trick.
Card trick.
It's
a terrible,
magic.
Basic card trick. So Kindly the Cowboy Show. First segment had a boy with a bully problem. Next segment has Kindly with roadkill that he'll eat. They need to take the intestines out, but the animal is still alive. That's pretty funny.
What was the show with the horse as well that
was that it used Kindly? Wasn't it?
Was it Kindly?
No, there's a horse in the background, right?
Yeah, no, but wasn't there an actual TV show like that had the horse that was talking?
And oh, I Mr. Ed?
Mr. Ed, that's it. Yeah. I couldn't think of Mr. Ed. So this is sort of like this, but of course it's like the twisted, like you were saying before, as it goes on, it kind of gets a little just like, what is going on here? Why yeah, are all were, these shows? Yeah,
it's like a cowboy show from like the 60s on reruns, like a Nick at Night sort of scenario.
Yeah.
Again, I'm old, but yeah, it's yeah, it's kind of one of those things where it's like the kindly cowboy.
Yeah.
There were shows like that back in the day.
And they showed this little glimpse of this cowboy episode earlier before, too.
That's what I was saying. Like, the first one's a bully, so it's like a traditional, like,
yeah,
older guy telling a young guy how to, like, mentoring him through, like, dealing with a bully. And then this one, it's like, here's, now I'm going to teach you how to kill and gut, roadkill, or whatever. But this thing's still alive, and it's just like, wow, okay.
So you're kind of starting to get that sense. I mean, you do in the magic trick one, but
again, it's escalating.
Like,
it's escalating. It's escalating. All it's
right.
escalating. Yeah. It's
yeah.
Like, it's like, okay, this is almost normal. It's a little skewed.
Yeah.
A little bit on the kooky side, but now it's just like, wait, what? yeah, so let me get on the 29th of December now, in terms of like the when these things are being taped. We get some random footage of stuff. And then Ralphie asks Mom if there's a haunted sorority house in their town. And she says, yes, so don't go there because it's haunted.
And now, great explanation, Mom.
I know, right? So then December 30th, they're at the theater to see Zombie Alien Hell 4, which, dang, we need to do that for our next episode. It sounds very grindhousey. And Ralphie is going to tape it. Then they see their dad there with another woman. What is he doing? Their mom seems awesome.
I know, right? She seems great. She seems beautiful. She's hands-on with the kid. When they go hiking, like, she seems just, yeah, I don't know.
But then again, it's one of those things where relationships can be messy. And yep. It's like, if you got to do the work. But anyway, so they leave the movie. They're hanging out in a rusty car. And Ralphie asks Josh if he wants to get married one day. And Josh thinks he does, but Ralphie is sure he wants to get married. Then Ralphie's reenacting the woman talking about burning the sorority house. And then they have the question, can ghosts touch you and kill you or just scare you and kill you? Which I'm like,
can they only give you a heart attack or when they touch you, does it... That's yeah. just such like the little kid mindset too.
Oh, absolutely. They talk about getting a ghost on camera, then they're watching TV again. Now we get the show Sleeping with Joan, not painting, cooking, or plumbing with Joan, which is apparently the rest of the day.
Now, does this mean, so speaking of the film Narcissism, is Joan the reason why she's kind of way out there because of film Narcissism? Because it seems like that she is has just a camera running
all
the time.
Yeah.
And that's the great part, too, where she's like, I'll fall asleep. I'll sit up with you. And she just stares at the camera. I want to be Joan. I want to be her so bad. I would love to just set up a camera like, let me fall asleep with me. And then just stare. I think it's so funny.
I mean, that would be a Twitch channel.
That's true, I guess.
I mean, there would be people who would, like, pay money to, like, have you do that.
Just yeah.
I mean, for better or worse.
I'll sit there with you while you fall asleep. Like her big glasses and everything.
I wish I was lying though. It's that's just great. Like that's the thing people like would be like, yes, I will
it's
support
true.
Your Twitch stream and you could probably make a living just but, like
yeah
being
that's
that.
True that is true.
But anyway, I love her advice to be sure to touch every blanket at the blanket store to find the right one. And she has either a space blanket or aluminum foil for sheets, which is
yeah.
like not even like a tinfoil hat but a full-on aluminum foil for her sheets. On the bedside table, she's got Lucky Bones and hair to keep away the night terrors along with cat's milk and whiskey. And then she'll stare at you until you fall asleep, as Leah was saying.
It's great.
And then we have a commercial for two discs of breakup songs, which...
Being sad has never sounded this good.
I remember those days of the two-disc, like, monster yep. ballads or, you know, that yep. kind of thing. And then we get sexy Swedish illegal aliens from space, XXX, our next episode, which I'm just like, dang, these titles...
I love it too. That same guy is there. Like this, it's the same actor guy. It's so great. I love the fact that they put that in there because it's like this guy is obviously one of those. You know what I mean? The B-rated pornos. Yeah, and he's
in all the.
He's
B-rated
in. Yeah, he's in all of them. Like.
Oh my gosh! They fixed all my machines. They fixed them. That was incredible.
Your farmhouse is over there, right? We'll go fix your machines.
Oh my God, they fixed my machines. That was incredible. They really fixed them. My machines are fixed.
We'll be right.
They're Swedish women from outer space who can fix anything. They're like mechanics.
It's, and they seem to actually be fixing things.
I know.
Anyway, so now Thomas Lane, the Reno 911 guy, is now on the antique show with a puppet he calls Jimmy the Rat, and the appraiser recognizes it from his childhood that it was stolen by a bully. And that was an interesting exchange. But then, wait, rocks? Something about rocks? Oh, they have something about rocks, excuse me. And then Joan's still staring at you, waiting for you to fall asleep.
Yes.
And then the bully's willing to sell Teddy the Rat for $650 after a $500 offer. And then we get interludes with Lou, the show the punk band was on.
Yes.
The interviewing girl, Natalie, she stopped by a video store, and the girl plays a song.
Yeah. But Natalie, the girl, which is I thought was weird, because isn't Natalie the one? She sings a song. Like, there's a girl band who sings a song, and she does it beautifully. Like, she does have a beautiful voice, but her parents seem to not be as into it as they were with the first rock band,
yeah,
who are just
music,
cursing.
Ironically, or whatever, which, or, she's not allowed to say this stuff. I mean, it's hilarious, and I dig the vibe. Then we get Lou and the girl dancing. Is this Lou's fantasy? Like, that's
maybe
the question I had, but...
Library Grindhouse will be back after these messages.
Unofficially brought to you by the music of Yes, available now on Hoopla. From their prog rock days of telling tales from topographic oceans to pop rock hits like Owner of a Lonely Heart, Hoopla has you covered. Dude, it's Yes!
And now back to the Library Grindhouse.
Anyway, as everything, it's all starting to escalate and get crazy. The parents come home on December 31st at 1:10 a.m., or someone's outside, one of the two. And then late afternoon, mom's taking her office somewhere, but dad is going to the movies.
Which now we know what that is code for.
Unfortunately.
He actually is going to the movies. Yeah, he actually is, but, well, unless he just says that every time. Who knows? Who knows?
I guess, yeah. And then we get some railroad tracks and scrap. Mom asks for the camera. And Ralphie's playing with the keyboard. Mom and dad are leaving again.
Which I thought that was kind of neat, too, because Ralphie doesn't like to be filmed.
Oh,
Ralphie
true.
Likes to do the filming, so he likes to put the camera on his mom, and then his mom's kind of getting like, here, let me do it to you, let's see how you like it, and he doesn't like it, and that's when she's like, you need to put down the camera, and they're on a beautiful hike. It is wonderful outside, and yeah, filming it obviously preserves your memory, but he's not experiencing it.
Well, it's a commentary on today, like, yeah, where everyone's constantly got their cameras like everywhere on all the time, and it's like, are you experiencing this or what?
Yeah, like, exactly.
I mean, yeah, so... We get Ralphie and Josh going to the haunted house, and they say, if we are watching, or you're watching this, we're dead. If you're watching this, we're dead, or whatever, something like that. So I'm just like, oh, this is going to get interesting.
Mm-hmm.
Josh plays a few notes on the piano. They turn around to go to another part of the house, play the piano again, turn around, see Rachel at the piano. Dun, dun, dun.
And this was the scariest part for me. So I'm watching this expecting it to be a horror film, and I'm not saying anything. I'm just cracking up laughing. That girl is horrifying. When the dead Rachel girl, mm-hmm. no bueno, no thank you.
So then they're in weird rooms full of like unspooled VHS tape and a TV. Ralph sees himself on the TV, it needs plugged in. Josh is trying to get him to go. They walk through a reception hall filled with people of the things they taped. Poisoning with Joan. It's crazy. They find a room with Ralphie's mom who asked why she married his dad. She remembers an orange tree and how good it smelled and thinking that'd be better if he was there. So she didn't care if he was late on like their date.
Yeah.
She just wanted to share it with him. That's nice.
It is nice.
And she tells him to go home, and they run screaming and leave the camera. The TV show detectives pick it up saying, we're on to something, which is kind of cool. And then we see executive produced by Susan Sarandon.
That was it.
Yeah, she executive produced it, which I'm just like, did she like the script? Like, again, or maybe, like you said, maybe it's
relation. Yeah.
Probably is. I should probably research that. But you know what? I'm cool either way. I like it as like a discovery thing of just like, like how Drew Barrymore discovered like Donnie Darko and is like, yes, we need to get this made. Get it. You know, I want to be in it. I want to produce it. I want to make this movie. The script is great. And like something like that where she was just a benevolent person who helped shepherd this project. You know.
Yeah.
But, so they shot on VHS and digital Betacam. They're a bunch of cheaters. They shot digital, not just analog.
Yeah,
VHS only.
Which I thought that they would have done all VHS, but I guess, I don't know. People watching this, hopefully you know what a VCR is. I would hope so. Maybe. Maybe? I don't know.
That's a good question.
Maybe. But I do want to comment on it. So what do you think it means that the detectives picked up his video camera? So, like the we're on to something or whatever. So are they...
Because that was the murder mystery guys.
Yeah.
And so it was like, that seemed like it was a fake, like a show. Like it was like, these are actors... performing a scene. It wasn't like a public access thing,
exactly.
Or like a ghost detective or a mystery, actual like detectives on a case kind of thing. It was more of like a scripted show. And so I mean, I think it might have been something where it's like, it's warping reality.
That's
where it's like the reality is getting warped. That's why it's like the ghost Rachel's there, and then like these detectives from the TV show are there. And it's part of it, it's still in the house, and the house is messed up on top of the tape narcissism, but at least it means that he's going to stop taping everything, which hopefully means his reality will be less warped.
See, in my mind, which I could be way too analytical on this, I just figured that the whole movie was actually Ralph's mind. Like, that was all in his mindset. So, like, the fact that he's watching these TV shows, it is warping his reality, and he's, like, kind of inputting his own take on everything, which can be scary. Imaginations can run wild, especially when you're that young.
Yeah, but at the same time, though, how does that affect, is it affecting, like, his parents' relationships, his relationship with his parents? Like, that's where I'm not entirely sure. Like, what does it mean that he's taping over their wedding? Like, what does it mean? Like, I got that that's kind of, like, just like their tape is getting tape deleted, like it feels like their marriage is like falling apart.
That's
like
true.
Their wedding video is getting broken, like that memory is getting like
destroyed,
erased.
Yeah.
Like their marriage is getting destroyed. Okay, that's a little on the nose, but I get it. However, at the same time, it's like, what is, does it mean anything in terms of what's going on in the movie? Like in terms of that, like is this, like his taping over stuff, or his taping this stuff isn't what's destroying the marriage. It's like, it feels like that's been going on for a while.
Yeah.
It doesn't feel like, I mean, maybe that was the first time that dad took that woman to the movies. And then it was like, that was so much fun, he's doing it again.
He's doing it again the very next day, too, which is weird.
A lot of movies come out at Christmas time. Even when, seriously, Christmas has been a time for movies.
I have to hit all the Christmas movies.
Well, no, I mean, like, how many, like, I remember Christmases where it's like, they're literally like five movies, and it's like, so what movie are we going to go see of these like five movies that just came out?
Yeah,
and so
true.
There, even like in the 80s, I think that was kind of a thing too.
Well, then is
like,
his dad a movie buff also? Is that sort of, because the mom's never in front of the TV, the mom's always standing outside drinking coffee, so like looking outside, being outside. Did you catch on to that?
Yeah, and maybe that's part of it where, like, you know, they have different things that they enjoy, like, which it's fine, but then at the same time, like, what do they enjoy together?
Together,
like,
yeah.
Like, the mom likes to sit there and, like, smell the orange trees, whereas he might prefer staying in and watching something, and then it's like, how do they reconcile those conflicting interests? Which I feel is part of every relationship, but it's one of those things where it's, like, right now it's not working out, and the dad's going to toxic lengths to, like, well, if you're not going to enjoy movies with me, I'm going to find someone to enjoy movies with. I have no clue what's going on there. And it's one of those things where, I mean, it's messy. Like, it's also, like, I feel like the messiness of the movie also reflects the messiness of relationships at the time, too.
Yeah.
And so I don't know if it has a larger meaning, a larger message. The fact that we can even talk about it, possibly having that, I mean, I guess is a testament to the fact that there is enough there to have a commentary. And it's also insanely entertaining.
Yes,
like, see all these
is.
Different things, like Painting with Joan.
Even
all
like
those kinds of things.
Even like the little commercials that they put in, like I don't know if it was in here or not, or if it just made me think it was like the Campbell's commercial where the kid walks in and he's a snowman, and then he drinks the Campbell's soup and he slowly melts away.
Oh right, I kind of remember.
And
that
I was
one.
Just like, ah, oh. Like that was. I remember that as a kid, or like the Disneyland
oh, sure.
commercials
mm-hmm.
where like, pack your bags, kid, we're going to Disneyland, like that sort of thing. If you miss those types of things on TV, this is the movie for you.
I think it's a very fun, like, retro, like, if you have fond memories of the 80s, if you're watching the Goldbergs like I am, then, you know, or, you know, remember taping things, like, on tape, like, definitely give this movie a watch. It's super fun. Even if you don't, I mean, it's one of those things where it's a fun time capsule, and there's a lot of good humor in it, as well as, like, a genuinely creepy section with that haunted house. Like, genuinely, like,
which I was surprised to see.
A little bit
that,
of paranormal activity.
Like I said, I jumped. And and like that whole scene when they're in their house is very creepy. They've got like film everywhere on the floor. And you can tell he's like being pulled into the TV. And then he goes to this alternate space where he's like sees all of the characters.
It's very kind of Shining-esque of like,
not
to spoil that film, but anyway.
But
yeah.
Yeah, so that was kind of neat. So thumbs up on this movie.
Absolutely, yeah. So, and now that was our thoughts on VHYes, so your clue for the next week's movie is...
Clucifer here. Your clue for the next film is, you'll wish the tape was blank.
All right, so be sure to let us know what you think next week's movie is, and what's the most precious memory you've taped over? I think that'll be our question for the comments.
Yes.
The most precious memory you've ever taped over. So for the Library Grindhouse, I'm Jesse.
And I'm Leah, and I'm going to go try and find the TV Guide channel. Bye.
All right.